Okay, second part of the chapter we start today, that is liquidator's statement of account. Yes, Kiran. Liquidator's statement of account means first we discuss director will give statement of affairs to the liquidator. Then liquidator will start selling the assets, and whatever money is realized by selling the assets, that will keep on paying to the liabilities which we studied in a particular order of payment that is to be done. Priority of order of payment is to be done. So if you remember in the first lecture itself we discussed there are two steps. One is sell the assets and recover the money, and then payments to be done in the order like first priority is secured creditors, then legal charges, then liquidators remuneration, then liquidation expenses, then preferential creditors, then creditors having including charge, unsecured creditors, preference shareholders and equity shareholders. So this we have studied the order of 13 order of payments. Now liquidator's statement of account will include this one. It has two sides, receipt side and payment side. In receipt side he records whatever money he has recovered by selling the assets, and on payment side he records whatever payments are being made by him, and the payments has to be in that pot. So that liquidator's statement of account now we are going to study. Is anyone clear with it? Here, important is regarding liquidator's remuneration. How do we give it? Liquidator's remuneration can be given on three different basis. Okay, understand it first. Liquidator's remuneration, you can decide on three different basis. One is fixed lump sum. So you can decide that liquidator will be given 50,000 fixed remuneration for doing all the formalities. Nothing else. So he'll take away his 50,000 from the very beginning so that later on if money doesn't remain, then he is not in a trouble. Second, you can give him remuneration on the basis of percentage given to unsecured creditors. Means you can give him remuneration like 5% of the payment made to unsecured creditors. Now unsecured creditors are the ones who get the payment at the end. After secured, after preferential, after creditors having prudent charge. So if you give him remuneration as a percentage of payment made to unsecured creditors, liquidator will make all efforts that he tries to pay each and every unsecured debt. Because if he pays to all unsecured creditors, his remuneration will also be more. So he will make all efforts to sell assets at higher value. After selling assets at higher value, he'll try to make payments in such a way that unsecured creditors do get the payment, because if they don't get the payment, he also doesn't get the remuneration. So this is a reason why you may decide to give a remuneration as percentage to unsecured creditors so that all the creditors are able to get the money. Okay, but still if creditors get the money, who are at the risk still? Shareholders, they get after the creditors. So you may also give him remuneration as percentage to shareholders. In that situation, again liquidator will make efforts to see that he tries to sell assets and recover so much money that the payment at least goes up to shareholders. Okay, you can also give him remuneration as, in fact four bases are there, percentage of assets realized. Means whatever amount he is able to recover by selling the assets, certain percentage of that. So again he will try to sell assets at maximum value as far as possible. So all these are just as an inspiration, as a motivation, as an incentive to the liquidator, so that he sells assets at higher value and so that he tries to make payment to everyone as far as possible. So four different bases are there. Do you understand this portion, everyone? Now no problem with fixed, no problem with percentage of assets realized. The problem is with these two. Why? Understand. When you decide to give him remuneration as a percentage to unsecured creditors. Okay, suppose we have unsecured creditors rupees 20,000 and cash available rupees 30,000 and percentage remuneration to liquidator is 5% of the payment made to unsecured creditors. Okay, now do we have enough cash available to pay all unsecured creditors or not? Here no problem. You pay 20,000 to unsecured creditors. What is 20,000's 5% remuneration? 1,000. That liquidator will take as his remuneration. Still 9,000 will remain, which you can make as payment to shareholders. Okay. But suppose vice versa. Unsecured paying girls are 30,000. Cash available is 20,000. And remuneration is 5%. First of all, do we have sufficient cash? Only 20,000, but we have to pay 30,000. We don't have sufficient cash. So how will you count the revenue? How much will you pay to the unsecured paying girls? 20,000. And then remuneration? 5%. 1,000. But we have only 20,000. So if you give 20,000 to unsecured paying girls, nothing remains for the remuneration. If you give 19,000 to the unsecured paying girls and 1,000 as remuneration, then does he really get 5% of the payment made to unsecured creditors? You are not making a payment of 20,000. You are paying only 19,000. 5% should be 9. Only 15,000. Why? 750. Then what about the left out amount 4,250? What will you do with the left out cash? Until all the unsecured creditors are paid, you cannot go to? That's what she said. 20,000 is 5%. 1,000 you take remuneration. 19,000 you pay to unsecured creditors. But then if you pay 19,000, he is not getting 5%. He is getting more than 5%. Because 19,000 is 5% is 900. 30,000 is 5%. 1,500. Even more remuneration. Cash is not there, you are giving him more remuneration. 30,000 is 5% means 1,500 remuneration. And you are not even paying 30,000 to the unsecured creditors. You have to give him 5% of the amount which you are going to pay to unsecured creditors. And the problem is we have only. So 20,000 is there from which we have to give amount to unsecured creditors also. And from that itself, we have to give remuneration also. So distribute it in the ratio. This 20,000, you distribute in the ratio of 100 is to 5. What do you mean by 100 is to 5? 100 upon 105. 5 upon 105. Do 20,000 into 100 upon 105. 19,004 and do 20,000. Into 5 upon 105. 952. Okay. So 19,048 and 952 into 20,000 is paid. Now cross check. What is 19,048 into 5%? 952. Does he get exactly 5% of the amount paid to liquidator and unsecured creditors or not? This is how it will be done. If cash is sufficient, no problem. If cash is insufficient, then you will distribute the amount between unsecured creditors and liquidator in the ratio of 100 is to liquidators. Do you understand the situation all of it? Okay. Here there is no trouble to give a fixed remuneration. Here there is no trouble. Once you sell the assets, whatever value the assets are sold, multiplied by the percentage remuneration you will give. The problem arises. Is everyone clear with this? Any confusion? And the last one, percentage to here. What is the rule? Equity shareholder supposed to talk about. Whatever is left out is to be paid to equity shareholders, even if it is less, even if it is more. They are the final owners who bear the risk. So if it is less, they have to bear the risk and the loss. Remaining cannot be paid. And if the amount is more, they are the owners. They bear the risk, so they will get the profit also. Surplus amount also will be given to them. So in case of equity shareholders, you cannot say that if equity share capital is 30,000, amount left is 20,000, or equity shareholders are 20,000, amount left is 30,000. How to give the remuneration? If equity shareholders are, equity share capital is 20,000, amount left is 30,000. Still you have to pay full 30,000 to equity shareholders. You'll give them more amount because they are the owners. And if equity share capital is 30,000, cash available is 20,000, then also you give 20,000 only to them because they have to bear the loss of 10,000. In short, in any of the situations, what will you give to equity shareholders, whatever the cash is? They may get more, they may get less. And if liquidator gets percentage on that, then from that 30,000 or 20,000 itself, we have to give amount to shareholders as well as remuneration to liquidator. So same procedure. So there you don't have to see amount is sufficient or amount is insufficient. Because whatever is left out is to be given to equity shareholders. Even if amount is more, full 30,000 will be given to equity shareholders. Even if amount is less, then 20,000 only will be given to equity shareholders. So in both the situations, if percentage of remuneration is given on the basis of shareholders, then you will always do it this way only. Means whatever amount is left out, 30,000 into 100 upon 105 you give to equity shareholders, 5 upon 105 you give remuneration to liquidator. And if 20,000 is left out, then 20,000 into 100 upon 105 upon 105. So when it comes to percentage to shareholders basis, then you'll always do it this way. But when it comes to unsecured creditor basis, then you have to see cash is sufficient or it is insufficient. If it is sufficient, then pay full amount to unsecured creditors and on that count remuneration. If it is insufficient, then distribute in the ratio. Did everyone understand this? Anyone have any doubt on this? So, first write down that diagram of four bases, then I'll dictate a note. Write down as a note below that. If liquidator's remuneration is on the basis of percentage of payment to unsecured creditors, comma, then full payment will be made if there is surplus. Like this one. If there is surplus, so full payment will be made 20,000, 5%. So, however, if there is deficiency, then amount will be distributed in the ratio of 100 is to liquidator's remuneration. 100 is to liquidator's remuneration. Okay, like we have done here, amount is in deficiency. So we have distributed this 20,000 in the ratio of 100 is to liquidator's remuneration. Understood that? Next paragraph. If liquidator gets remuneration as percentage of payment to shareholders, always it will be distributed in the ratio of 100 is to liquidator's remuneration. Understood that? In case of equity shareholders, whatever cash is left out, we have given to equity shareholders only, so always you distribute it in the ratio of 100 is to liquidators remuneration. Any confusions with this? Look at page number 73. Can you see after statement of affairs, very first point is regarding liquidators remuneration. Look at those points. It is calculated in the following: A is fixed amount, B is remuneration on the percentage of assets realized, C is payment made to unsecured creditors, and third is payment made to shareholders. Note, liquidators remuneration can be either one or more than one of the above also. So not necessary that any one can only be given. We can give in all the four also. 5,000 fixed, 2% of assets realized, 3% of unsecured creditors, 4% to shareholders. All the four can also be given. Points to be considered for calculating liquidators remuneration. First, if liquidator's remuneration of assets does not include cash in hand or bank, unless otherwise stated, cancel the word if. So when there's a percentage of assets realized, it's quite logical and common sense can also be used. Cash in hand and cash at bank. Does liquidator have to make any effort to realize that? Cash in hand and bank is already available. So when we give him remuneration of percentage of assets realized, it will never include cash in bank, unless otherwise stated. If it is in the agreement that even cash in hand and bank is to be included, then it can be included. But if nothing is stated, that means it will not be included. Percentage of assets realized in assets will not include cash and. Then realization of assets does not include cash in hand or bank unless otherwise stated. Second, in case of assets which is specifically pledged, you get this point? Assets which is specifically pledged means? Loudly. Sunita? List B means which is given to secured creditors as a security. Who is going to sell that? Suppose land and building is mortgaged with bank. Bank may sell it or even liquidator may sell it. Okay, it may be decided. Bank sells it, then bank will pass on the surplus amount. Liquidator sells it, then liquidator will pay to the bank first and remaining will pay for others. So, in case of asset which is specifically pledged and it is realized by the concerned creditor himself, means who sells it? Bank sells it. Concerned creditor himself, realized by the concerned creditors himself, bank sells it. Then liquidator's remuneration is paid only on the surplus realized by him. So suppose land and building is of 10 lakhs, unsecured creditors are of 8 lakhs, bank building is sold for 10 lakhs, and bank only sells it. Then bank will retain 8 lakhs and 2 lakhs it will give to the liquidator to pay to others. In here, liquidator is recovering how much amount from that? Only 2 lakhs. So you'll get remuneration only on. In case of mortgage or hypothecation, see this language is allowed to see in examples. If the word is used pledged, pledge means what? No, pledge and mortgage, what is the difference? Understand it. Normally it's mortgaged or hypothecated. In pledge, what happens? If I give this bench as a pledge, then the person who is taking it as a security will take this bench along with him. Generally, jewelry we pledge. Jewelry we pledge means we keep it with the other person, and until we repay the money, the jewelry remains with him. That kind of a thing is called pledged. So if any asset is pledged, means the pledge is with the creditor, so he only will sell it. Okay, but mortgage and hypothecation means what? Normally it is done. If I today buy a car and take it on a car loan, then I will have to hypothecate or mortgage my car with the bank. Who has the car right now? Car is with me, but the papers and title deeds are hypothecated in the name of the bank. So in case of mortgage or hypothecation, the asset is with the company only. Who will sell it? Liquidator will sell. In case of mortgage or hypothecation, if liquidator himself realizes the assets, he will be allowed remuneration on full value of assets realized. So we have to see this language in the question. If pledge is mentioned, that means the creditor has to sell the assets because he has the possession of assets. And if it is mortgage or hypothecation, then company has the possession of assets, then generally liquidator would sell it and he will get remuneration on full amount. In case of pledge, creditor sells it, so liquidator will get remuneration only on surplus amount. Any doubt up till here? If liquidator's remuneration is based on preferential of amount distributed to unmade percentage, not preferential. If liquidator's remuneration is based on percentage of amount distributed to unsecured creditors, then unsecured creditors include preferential creditors unless otherwise stated. Means this situation. If you give him remuneration on the basis of percentage to, then you have to give him remuneration as percentage of preferential creditors also. Preferential creditors are basically unsecured only. But as per the government law, they are to be paid in priority, like wages and salaries. Okay, then investigation expenses, then government taxes, they are also. But the only thing is government has asked to pay those in priority before unsecured papers. Nothing is mentioned. Then if you give him percentage of remuneration to unsecured creditors, means you have to give him that percentage of preferential creditors also. And if it is specifically mentioned that excluding preferential creditors, then you will give only on unsecured. But if nothing is mentioned, then percentage to unsecured creditors means percentage of preferential creditors also and percentage of unsecured creditors also. Did everyone understand this? Second, in case liquidator's remuneration is based on the last in the order of payment. Last in the order of payment means shareholders. Either because the amount is insufficient or residual money is inclusive of liquidator's remuneration. In that case, remuneration calculated as 100 plus percentage of liquidator's remuneration. Like we have done here, 100 is to liquidator's remuneration. Did everyone understand this? See, this is how liquidator's final statement of account appears format. It is a summary of cash book. As I told you, it's like a cash book only. Left side will show the receipts, right side will show the payments. After the beginning of liquidation process, it is only a treatment presented in the form of an account. No double entries involved in preparation of it. So receipts side, very first we include cash and bank. Then we include amount received from realization of assets. In case of surplus from securities, assets specifically charged in favor of creditors. Means if asset is given to creditor in security, then you include only surplus amount. And for other assets, you include full amount. Okay, those assets which are given in security, you include only surplus amount. And for other assets, you include full amount. Calls in arrears, calls from contributors. What are these calls in arrears we already know? What is this calls from contributors? If there are 10,000 equity shares of 10 each paid up, means company is not yet called 2 rupees. Now when the company goes into liquidations, then shareholders should first pay the full money. But there is no point in calling the money from the shareholders and repaying back to them. So we call the money from shareholders only if there is deficiency. Means when paying the money, if preferential creditors, floating charge, unsecured creditors, any point that deficiency arises, then we call the money from contributors. Is everyone clear with this? The calls from contributors will arise only if the shares are partly. Now payment side. Very first priority is legal charges. Then liquidator's remuneration. This we have studied already. then liquidation expenses, then workmen's dues, basically we include them in preferential creditors only. Then creditors having probate charge on assets of the company, that is generally it will include debenture holders, then unsecured creditors, and then we'll return the money to the owners, contributors, that is preference shareholders and equity shareholders. Did you understand this? So normal format, receipts and now first three examples are done. Look at question number 4. See, cash available for distribution to unsecured creditors is ₹10,000. Unsecured creditors are 8,000. Surplus or deficiency? Surplus. How much is cash? 10,000. Payment to unsecured creditors to be made? So this situation. Liquidator's remuneration is 5% of amount given to unsecured creditors. Can we give full remuneration or not?
Yes, sir.
So calculate the remuneration on the basis of unsecured creditors. Like remuneration will be 8,000, 5%? 400. 8,400 we have to pay the money. Okay. So simple, write down. Liquidator's remuneration is equal to 8,000 into 5%, that is 400. Okay, any doubt in this? Look at question number 5. Okay, cash, now see vice versa. Cash available is 8,000, but unsecured creditors are 10,000. Now we have deficiency. So from 8,000 only we have to pay to unsecured creditors as well as liquidators' remuneration. Now we'll do it in this ratio. Liquidators' remuneration at 5% of the amount distributed to unsecured. Calculate liquidators' remuneration. So now we'll do it this way. Cash available is 8,000, which will be distributed between unsecured creditors and liquidators' remuneration in the ratio of 100 is to, what is liquidators' remuneration? 5. So 100 is to, did you understand this? Because there is deficiency. So 100 upon 105, 5 upon 105. Now 8,000 into 100 upon 105, 7, 6, 19. And 8,000 into 5 upon 105. And cross check, 7,619 into 5%. So whatever we are paying to unsecured creditors, liquidated does get 5% of that as remuneration. Did you understand this portion, everyone? Any doubts up till here? Shall I proceed with question 6? Anyone still doing it? Look at it. Cash available, unlike before making payment to unsecured creditors, is 30,000. Unsecured creditors are 10,000, so surplus is there. Equity share capital is also there, 15,000. So out of 30,000, first we'll pay 10,000 to unsecured creditors. What remains? 20,000. Now though equity share capital is only 15,000, I explained it here. Because they are the final owners. Whatever is left out, 20,000 entire will be paid to equity shareholders. Now here, calculate liquidator's remuneration if it is 5% of the amount distributed amongst shareholders. I told you if it is amongst the percentage of shareholders, then always do it in the ratio. Because whatever 20,000 is left out, entire is to be given to shareholders only. So out of 20,000 itself, we have to give to shareholders as well as remuneration to the liquidator. Did everyone understand it? So always have to do it in this ratio only. First, cash available before making payment to unsecured creditors is 30,000. Now first from this we'll make the payment to unsecured creditors, that is 10,000. How much will still be available? 20,000. Now though equity share capital is only 15,000, but from this 20,000 we have to give entire amount to equity shareholders as well as we have to give remuneration to the liquidator. So this 20,000 now will distribute between equity shareholders and liquidators' remuneration in the ratio of 100 is to, what is the remuneration's percentage? 5. So 100 upon 105 and 5 upon 105. 20,000 is paid done here. Yes. 19048 we will give to equity shareholders and 952 we will give as remuneration to the. Is everyone clear with this? 20,000 into 100 upon 105. 19048 will give to equity shareholders. And 20,000 into 5 upon 105, 952 will give us remuneration to the liquidator. And you can cross check, 19,048's 5% is 952. So any confusion with this? So these are just objective examples. We are understanding how to count the remuneration in the main examples. This will be like our workings when we do the main examples. Okay. Our main example is the 8th one to be it. No, 7th, sorry. 7th is remaining person. That's not the main one. A liquidator is entitled to receive remuneration at 3% of assets realized. Then 5% of amount distributed amounts and secured creditors. Now two bases are given. He also gets 3% of assets realized and he also gets 5% of amount to, given to unsecured creditors. Assets realized rupees 10 lakhs. And surplus as regards unsecured creditors was 3 lakhs. As regards unsecured creditors. So, first of all, assets realized how much? So, 10 lakhs, 3%, you will get 30,000. Now, surplus as regards unsecured creditors means after paying to unsecured creditors, there is already a surplus of 3 lakhs. Find out the amount of liquidator's remuneration if liquidation expenses amount to 10,000. Preferential creditors were 90,000 and amount of unsecured creditors including preferential creditors were rupees 4 lakhs. Then find out liquidator's remuneration. So how much is the surplus as regards unsecured creditors? Yes. Means cash available is only 3 lakhs. Yes. But unsecured creditors are 4 lakhs including preferential creditors. So we have to distribute in this ratio amount as in deficiency. 100 is to 5%. Is everyone clear with this? So let us do it. First of all, surplus regards unsecured creditors means cash available is 3 lakhs. Okay, surplus as regards unsecured creditors means cash available is 3 lakhs. From that very first, we will give liquidators remuneration of percentage of assets realized, which is 3% on assets realized means 10 lakhs into 3%. He will get 30,000. So after giving that, how much cash will be left out? 2,70,000. Okay. Then first in the priority, we will pay liquidation expenses. That is 10,000. How much cash will be still left out? 2,60,000. Any doubts up till here? All right, everybody follow this. Now, after liquidation expenses, in the order the priority is? Preferential creditors. So preferential creditors will pay 90,000. How much cash is still left out? 1,70,000. Now we discussed in the previous page that if you give remuneration to the liquidator on the basis of amount distributed to unsecured creditors, then you have to give that percentage on preferential creditors also. So once we have made preferential creditors payment of 90,000, then immediately liquidator also becomes entitled to get remuneration on this. So again we'll have to give remuneration to the liquidator. Again we'll have to give remuneration to the liquidator, which is on preferential creditor 90,000 into 5%, 4,500. Did you understand this or not everyone? If liquidator gets remuneration as amount distributed to unsecured creditors, then you have to give it that remuneration of preferential creditors also. Right everyone? So 1,70,000 minus 4,500, 1,65,500 is still left out. After preferential creditors, next turn is of unsecured creditors. How much are unsecured creditors? 4 lakhs. Out of that, 90 including preferential. So out of 4 lakhs, 90 are preferential. Means 3,10,000 are unsecured creditors. So there is surplus or deficiency? Deficiency. Deficiency means this amount we will distribute in the ratio of 100 is to 5. So out of this, unsecured creditors and liquidators remuneration will be given in the ratio of 100 is to 5. 100 upon 105, 5 upon 105. So do it 165, 500 into 100 upon 105. 157,619 and 165 pi into pi upon 105. 7881. And you can cross check. How much are we paying to unsecured creditors? 157,619. Do 157,619 into 5%. 7881. Do you all get this or not, everyone? So finally, liquidators get which remunerations? 30,000 plus 4,500 plus 7881. Main question asks this calculate liquidator's remuneration that we can show at the end. Therefore, liquidator's remuneration is equal to, okay, therefore liquidator's remuneration is equal to 30,000 plus 4,500 plus 7881. 4, 2, 3, 8, what? Did everyone understand this? Anyone having any doubt on it? All of them bits. So this is how we calculate the remunerations. Okay? We can take a with full-fledged example now. So question number 8, that is full-fledged example or liquidators statement of account. Someone stop it.